Success, Guns N' Roses style.
There were photo sessions when Slash literally was propped up so he wouldn't fall down for the photo session.
When Behind the Music continues. By the summer of 1986, Guns N' Roses had navigated the thicket of Hollywood hair metal to bag a multi-album deal with Geffen Records. But the label was worried that their explosive investment could combust at any moment.
Well, I was worried about them surviving because you can't tell junkies or drug addicts to stop taking drugs. They probably laughed when I said, guys, I mean, be careful, you know, you're going to be the biggest rock and roll band in the world. You don't need to destroy it with this crap.
I always kind of thought that, you know, there would be like the explosion and it would all be over, or one of them would die, or something would happen.
We're the bad boys.
In August of 86, Geffen got Guns into the studio. But the band never allowed a rigid recording schedule to cramp their untamed style.
On any given night, terrorizing Hollywood. Every morning, we'd have to get up and somehow manage to be in the studio by 12.
They came in many, many times, well hungover.
But amid all the chaos, Guns N' Roses were about to make musical history. One of the songs that emerged in those early sessions was a disarmingly sensitive ballad called Sweet Child of Mine. Ironically, Slash came up with its classic opening riff as a joke.
We were rehearsing, the young guitar center, and then he started playing like a circus kind of thing. You know? And I was all, dude, play that again.
What started out as a joke guitar riff for me turned into a huge anthem for Axl as far as that relationship that he was in at the time. So it was a very heartfelt moment in his life.
Axl's unusually affectionate lyrics were penned as a love letter to his girlfriend, Erin Everly, with whom he had had a tumultuous five-year relationship.
When it was good, and when it was bad, it was horrible. There was a lot of turmoil between those two, and that's all I want to say.
Erin was a very nice girl. She was cute as could be. She was just the opposite as Axl. But it also shows a side of Axl, Sweet Child of Mine, that you wouldn't necessarily when you hear all these nasty things about him.
But Sweet Child was a rare track of tenderness. On an album dominated by incendiary anthems like Welcome to the Jungle. And when Appetite for Destruction was released in July of 87, it bombarded fans with a brutal sonic diary of five musicians hanging on the edge by a thread.
They were, you know, they were living, you know, hand to mouth, and they were just all about the rock and the girls and the drinks, and that's what they sang about. That's what they did. And they lived it.
It's a pretty much a storybook of everything that Axl and the band was going through from, say, the beginning of the 80s all the way up until the record was finished.
In August of 87, Guns hit the road for a world tour to support the album, taking their never-ending Hollywood party to inebriated extremes around the globe.
They're just a bunch of crazy kids that had just been given the key to every city in the world, you know, basically.
There were photo sessions when Slash literally was propped up, you know, the head up and somebody behind him, you know, to hold him up so he wouldn't fall down for the photo session.
Slash is a very dedicated player. He would go and throw up behind the amps, come back out, keep playing. He'd smoke on stage, and his cigarette would drop down in between his pants and his stomach. And I'm sitting there watching him going, you know, dude, you're burning up. And he's just doing the solo in pain.
The Guns' outrageous antics and graphic lyrics were infuriating parents, but delighting fans. And in July of 88, Appetite for Destruction climbed to number one on the charts.
It was the right band at the right time with the right message, and it just happened to hit the youth of America in a certain way that everybody related to it, which is f-ing great.
But just as the band reached multi-platinum heights, tragedy brought them crashing back to earth. On August 20th, 1988, during the Guns set at the Monsters of Rock Festival in Donington, England, two fans were crushed and killed by the frenzied audience.
And so we finished the gig. Our manager didn't tell us about it, so we met up at a pub later on, and I found him in the bar sort of crying, and he told me about that. And it's like, that was when the reality kicked in, that you can get to this all-time high, something that you can't compare to anything, and then have it go to an all-time low.
It really screws with your head. He drove to the show with his friends. They were having a good time. They got out of their car. They walked into the gig, and he didn't walk out.
The deaths at Donington added fuel to a growing critical fire against the band and to the sentiment that GNR were headed for premature destruction. Next, the Guns' turn on Steven Adler.
I did everything I possibly could to try and kill myself.
When Behind the Music continues. By the end of 1988, Guns N' Roses had launched a multi-platinum blast of dirt and grime onto the airbrushed face of rock and roll. Just 1 year after the release of their debut album, they were one of the most popular bands in the world.
They were the baddest thing on the block at the time.
They had a certain genuineness to them that I think people really attached themselves to. They were what they were, and what you saw is what you got.
I had no expectations for it to be such a global event.
One, two, one, two, three, four.
In November of 88, Guns released the EP GNR Lies, a collection that included four new tracks knocked out in a single inspired studio session.
Was a time when I wasn't sure, but you set my mind at ease.
Driven by the top 10 ballad Patience, the record would go on to sell 2 million copies.
Basically, it was a live session. I recorded everybody in the same room and in a circle, and they all played together, and it was pretty magical.
We did Lies record, and it was like a real easy, quick thing to do, which was really successful, which was sort of a shock. One day's work, and sells like all these copies.
Despite their success, controversy constantly threatened to disarm the Young Guns. Another of the tracks on GNR Lives was One in a Million, a divisive tune with racially charged lyrics that put the band under fire.
The word was used on the record, but that didn't necessarily mean all black people. It just, you know, it meant basically lowlifes, people that were like stealing, you know, to supply their drug habits.
It hit home with me on a bad level because I'm half black for one. So you start saying the word it's very unsettling.
But the storm of protest only fueled album sales. And in February of 89, as GNR Lies joined Appetite for Destruction in the top five, the band decided to take a break from recording and the road. But their downtime quickly became an endless succession of wanton days and wasted nights.
That's where we really went downhill. That's where I got lost, Izzy got lost, Steven got lost, Duff even got lost, and Axel disappeared somewhere.